Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this first Sunday of the Advent season here at Moreland Presbyterian. I'm Brian Marsh, the pastor. I want to welcome all of you who are with us here in the sanctuary, those of you who are with us online. Hi, David. I see you up there. We even have people in our balcony this week. We're very excited to be entering into the Advent season and to be doing it this year together in person instead of having to do everything online like we did last year. Steps in the right direction. We're really glad that you're here. Want to especially welcome those of you who may be visiting us for the holidays or are with us for the first time. Whether this is your first time or Moreland is your regular gathering place for spiritual community, we always like to remind ourselves that we are ordinary, imperfect people here. And we're an ordinary, imperfect church. And we are connected by an extraordinary, imperfect love that gives us life and hope and light to share with each other and to share with our neighbors and with our world. So our hope this week and every time we come together is that you feel welcome, that you feel like this is a safe space, that you feel free to enter into our time together in the ways that are meaningful for you and comfortable for you. So it's really great to be together. It's really great to be entering into the season of Advent together. Our theme for this season is the Inn, welcoming the wondrous. And you may be noticing some things as we move through the season, one of which is right behind me back here on the narthex. You'll see that there isn't a lot up there right now. And part of the reason for that is that we're exploring this theme of welcome over the course of the season through that image of the inn. And so our own Bill Taylor, with his creative wondrousness, created an inn door to put on our chancel, along with a couple of lanterns there, and you will be seeing this chancel take shape week by week over the course of the season. You'll also notice that our Chrismons tree is up and that there is nothing on it, because next week we'll have the opportunity to place our Chrismons ornaments upon this tree and also the white ribbons upon the bush outside of our sanctuary on Bybee, and that'll be a chance for us and anyone in the neighborhood to write our wishes and hopes and prayers for the season and put the ribbons on the bush outside. So there are lots of things that will be taking shape and appearing before our eyes over the course of this season. We invite you to join us on the journey. We're excited and anticipating what will be revealed over these next weeks to come. As we enter into our time together today, I do want to make mention that we lost two very beloved and dear souls and parts of our community here at Moreland just this past week. Two of our Bobs, Bob Johnson and Bob Wood, both passed away within 2 days of each other this past week. And so as we enter into our time today, we'll do so honoring them and remembering their amazing, kind, compassionate, and joyful presence among us. And so we can be remembering the Johnson family and the Wood families in our prayers and in our thoughts as we move into our time together today. And so as we do move into our time together today, we do so first by a call to worship and lighting of the prophecy candle of hope. We will do that musically, and then Chris Blattner and Cindy McCann will lead us in our call to worship and lighting of the candle.
Thank you.
Hope waits for us to trust.
Hope waits for our commitment.
To a land that's kind and just.
In this time of preparation for the work of co-creation,
for the birthing of a world that heals the ones in pain, hope is born in us again.
Today we offer the light of hope to illumine the door of welcome to the wondrous. May this light shine in our hearts, in our lives, and in our community. May hope awaken us to possibilities and lead us to greater hospitality. There is room in this inn, a house for the holy.
O come, let us adore the wondrous one. Amen. Our hymn of praise is O Come, Emmanuel, the first two verses. We invite you, remaining masked, to join with us, and let's sing together our opening hymn of praise. I invite us to take a few moments and just in silence, allow what you are thankful for to enter your mind. And in silence, give thanks for those gifts, those blessings, simple and profound, in your lives. Together, let's give thanks. And in that same spirit of gratitude, let's open ourselves to the parts of our lives that are weighing us down. The things that keep us up at night. The things that cause us anxiety and concern. The losses that we have experienced and are experiencing. The things that we wish could be different. The things that we are longing to change, the parts of our lives that we are needing to release, to let go of. And as we enter into a space to allow those things to surface and to offer them up, to the God of love, the God of grace. Let's do that together, first in song and then in silence. In the name of the one who knows us fully and loves us freely. Amen. Our hopes and our fears are met in the tears and transcendence of unconditional, unlimited love. In Jesus the Christ, we are accepted, we are forgiven, we are loved. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now I invite you to stand. And let's sing our song of gratitude. Safely from a distance. Pass the peace with those who are present here and those of you who are online through the comments section on Facebook Live or any other means you have. Peace be with us all.
I'm going to be Good morning.
Good morning.
Today our readings are from Jeremiah 33:14-16 and 1 Thessalonians 3:9-13. The days are surely coming, says Yahweh, when I will bestow on Israel and Judah all the blessings I promised them. In those days, and at that time, I will raise up righteous branch from the line of David, who will bring justice and integrity to the land. In those days, Judah will be safe and Jerusalem will be secure. They will call the land, Yahweh is our justice. Paul said, how can we thank God enough for you, for all the joy we feel before God on your account? We earnestly pray night and day to be able to see you again and make up for any shortcomings in your faith. May our loving Abba God and Jesus, our Savior, direct our steps back to you. May Christ increase to overflowing your love for one another and for all people, even as our love does for you. May Christ strengthen your hearts, making them blameless and holy before our Abba God at the coming of our Savior Jesus with all the holy ones. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us.
Thanks be to God.
No, I'm sorry. No, sweetie, come up here first.
Got it? Okay. Let's have a seat. All right. So, now is the time for getting ready. And we're about to come to a great mystery. And if we don't stop, if we don't slow down, we could not even notice that the great mystery of Christmas is coming. And so the church set aside these 4 weeks of Advent to help us get ready. But how can we get ready? There are many different ways. So I know that if I brought this box home to my house, there would be plenty of excitement, anticipation. There'd be plenty of wondering about what's inside. Are you guys wondering what's inside? So let's see. Go ahead and you can just press or just pull that, right? Okay. But what if we took off the ribbon and opened the box? And well, it seems empty, but maybe not. As Christians, as humans, we have something powerful on our side. We have hope. And hope is what lets us look at something not as it is, but what it could be. So we take a look at this box, and it might look empty to us, but when we have hope, we know that it is filled to the brim with something awesome. It's filled with possibilities. So in this box, there is room for creativity, and there's room for generosity. There's room for compassion. There's room for kindness. There's room for the spirit. There's room for possibilities. And Advent, that's the season of possibilities. including the possibility that a child born 2,000 years ago in a stable, that child changed everything. So, how can we get ready? Let's look around for possibilities. Let's look around for ways to get into that mystery. There's going to be so many ways around in this church. There's ways at home. There's ways in our community with our neighbors. So let's make room, look for possibilities, find something that seems empty, and fill it with hope. Amen. So now,
let's pause for some moments to breathe and pray. God, we're thankful for a season in which there is the promise of hope. And we're reminded that hope that we can see really isn't hope. But it's what fires our imaginations, what stirs our hearts, what sets our eyes and ears and minds and hearts wondering about possibilities. Thank you for these words from the pages of Scripture to spark our imaginations and fire our curiosities. By the presence of your Spirit, would you speak these words into the pages of our lives in ways that we can hear and know and understand and live. So may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and dreams and meditations of our hearts be a delight to you, for God, you are our delight. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. I do want to mention that for those of you who have a bulletin, you'll see a listing that we're celebrating communion today. That was my typo. I want to fully own that. I was excited. We're having communion next week. But just wanted to give you that heads up. It's good to see you, Bob. Well, Brian, it's good to be seen. And in the 6 years that I knew Bob Johnson, that was how we greeted each other, each and every time we saw each other. Good to see you. It's good to be seen. And that always brings a smile to my face, not only because it reminds me of Bob's endearing sense of humor, but also because of his caring heart and his character. I remember Bob as being someone who cherished chances to see others, to be seen by others, to connect with others. But he also knew especially the importance of being seen. He always provided a reminder to me of that desire and that need that we all have, both to know others and to be known by others, to recognize that through all that we live through in life, perhaps our greatest hope is to know that we are known and to know that we are not alone. So not only did our Moreland community lose a big part of our caring heart this past week with Bob's passing, and also the passing of dear Bob Wood, but our human community lost a huge part of its creative spark through the passing of Stephen Sondheim on Friday. Stephen Sondheim was not only a musical giant and genius, he was the greatest composer for the American theater in the past 50 years, and I'll arm wrestle you on that. He not only created miraculous and inspiring works of artistry, he literally transformed our understanding and experience of what musical theater can be and the ways that it can communicate and touch us on multiple levels. Sondheim wrote so many amazing and memorable classic songs throughout all of the musicals that he wrote. But my favorite of all of his songs comes from my favorite musical of his, Into the Woods. And it's the penultimate song, the climax of the story. No One Is Alone. It's a song that starts from a place of acknowledging the losses that we experience through the challenges that we face, the uncertainties and the anxieties as we make our ways through the dark and foreboding woods in our lives. Losses of parents, loved ones, guides, and lights in our lives. Losses of ideals and direction. Losses of innocence and blissful unawareness. All of these losses leave us feeling isolated, unseen, alone. And yet, the refrain returns repeatedly, you are not alone. No one is alone. Sondheim's way of saying, you are seen. You are known. Well, into a landscape of life that more often than not is harrowing rather than hallowing, and seems to be more destructive than healing, words of hope came to two hurting communities in ancient times, and through those communities to our hurting human community today. Communities that were separated by centuries, but connected by calling and connected by spirit. The prophet Jeremiah was speaking his words of hope to one nation that was divided in two. Divided by distrust, by discord. One nation, Israel, having lived through exile in Assyria, and the other nation, Judah, currently living through exile in Babylon. And those words of hope speak of a promise that out of the relational and generational line that connects those two nations as one, there will arise a new sprig of hope and life. A sign of hope that will bring justice and equality and holiness and bring integrity, integration, wholeness to all people. It will bring a new way of seeing and knowing each other again as one people, as one humanity. And then centuries later, the Apostle Paul, writing to one of the first Christian communities in Thessalonica, affirming them for their faithfulness, not only to Christ and to Paul and his cohort, but to each other, to their neighborhood, to their broader community, and desiring not only to see them and be with them again, but also that they would be empowered by that same spirit to see and to know each other and their neighbors and all people more fully, more completely. These words of hope are powerful. They're promising. They're wonderful. But I wonder, how could this hope that both the prophets speak of be actually made real? How can it be made real in the midst of a reality where, in Sondheim's words, people make mistakes? Fathers, mothers, nations, communities, people make terrible mistakes Everybody makes mistakes holding on to their own, thinking they're alone. A divided nation and world was not just a reality millennia ago. It's our lived reality right here and now. A global pandemic that's keeping us apart and driving a deeper wedge between us regarding our responses to the pandemic, our levels of trust in our leaders in the worlds of public health, the political realm, our increasing distrust even of each other. A humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan that's causing citizens to flee from that country as refugees to other countries, including our own, and even to our own state, where it was first reported as 180 individuals coming to Oregon needing welcome and essential provisions. But now that number has increased to 1,200. With almost half of those estimated to arrive here by February. And not only that humanitarian crisis, but another humanitarian crisis right here in our own city, which has led more people to be living out on the public streets and in public spaces than at any other time in recent memory, including right here in our own church neighborhood. Into all of these crises and so many more, I wonder, what could real hope possibly even look like? And how might we make room for this kind of hope in lives that are so uncertain and so overcrowded already? Well, I know that so often in this season of Advent, we focus on the coming of the one child, whom we celebrate as the one bearer of peace and justice and love for our world. And while this is a central and essential part of our celebration, I find it interesting that this one child, this wondrous one, so often reflects that desire to bring peace and justice to our world back towards us, as if to say, you are all vessels of this peace and justice, and I have come to invite you to awaken more fully to your deeper calling to be the bearers of peace and justice and hope and mercy and equality and empowerment and love, the calling that you were created for. And I hear in those words the echo of Paul's words when he encouraged his community that they might increase to overflowing in love for one another and for all people. So I wonder if perhaps a real hope in our times would involve celebration. Celebrating the incredible divine gifts that are within us and among us, and the gifts that are yet to emerge. But not only celebration, that the celebration could lead to an awakening and a sensitizing ourselves to the presence and the circumstances of those of us who are not seen and not known and do not have what is needed for flourishing in life. And that this awakening and sensitizing may then lead to a connecting and a partnering with our neighbors in greatest need to ensure that they are seen, that they are known, that this openness between us can lead to provision and flourishing, equality and justice being experienced by all of us mutually. That we might be reminded that hope is not just something that we're waiting for, but but something that is empowering us to realize the beloved community that we are right here and right now. And when I think of this, I wonder further, might we make room for this hope in our midst this Advent by finding our ways back to each other? To connect intentionally, in person, online, through any other means available. To connect in genuine community with openness, with authenticity, and with vulnerability. To share our lives with each other deeply. To find strength and encouragement from each other in that same spirit by truly seeing each other, knowing each other more fully. And could this deeper sense of seeing each other and knowing each other more fully empower us to then engage our neighbors in the same spirit? I can understand how this prospect might give us a sense of uneasiness, uncertainty, hesitancy, even fear, thinking about engaging with others who we haven't seen for quite some time, engaging with others who might see life differently than we do, those whom we might even disagree, engaging with others who we've never even met before in our neighborhood. I get that. There is some real reasons to feel some uncertainty and hesitancy. And yet, in instances like this, I am reminded of the power of simple actions. To take a few moments before encountering someone, to breathe, to pray, to open myself to the divine presence within me, that it might open me to that deeper power of being vulnerable with someone else, which then might open my senses to the divine presence within that other person. Greeting that other person by looking them in the eyes. We can still do that even with masks on. Maybe we do it more often now. Looking that person in the eyes, if we don't know them, introducing ourselves, asking their name. Regardless of how differently we may experience life, regardless of the differences in our circumstances and our convictions, time and time again, I have found myself, when I engage someone else in this way, and in this spirit, I find myself open to experience that divine presence that's not only within us, but actually connects us. It's a mutual seeing each other and knowing each other, which is, amazingly enough, the safe space that we are both looking for and longing for in our lives. And in those moments, I'm reminded, again in the words of Sondheim, that while someone is on your side, our side, someone else is not. And while we're seeing our side, maybe we forgot that they are not alone. That no one is alone. My friends, we are seeing others in their distress. We are opening ourselves more fully to knowing people through welcome in these days. We're befriending our neighbors at Willamette Center with food, with friendship. Most recently, some of us preparing food and serving it on Thanksgiving Day. We are enacting this by taking tangible steps towards welcoming and hosting an Afghan family, a family that will be needing shelter and provision, but most importantly, connection, community. There will be more information about the myriad of ways that you can connect in with this welcoming community in the days and weeks to come. But I wonder, might our making room for this kind of hope extend to our neighbors who are currently without safe shelter right here on the streets of our neighborhood? Might it extend to our neighbors who are housed and yet who are struggling silently and feeling all alone and who need a caring presence to see them and to know them and to remind them that they are not alone? Perhaps the prophets, Jesus and Jeremiah and Paul and Stephen, can help inspire and empower us in our response. Hard to see the light now. Just don't let it go. Things can come out right now. We can make it so. And then in a slight twist to the Sondheim canon, someone is on all sides. No one is alone. Amen.
God, we're so grateful for the opportunity to gather today. We're so grateful for the prophetic words that have been spoken to us, with us today. God, this morning we ask that you remind us to not just tell people that they aren't alone, to not just tell people that you're there, you're with them, but to be the person who is with. To practice a radical withness to the people around us. God, we ask you for guidance as we attempt to embody your spirit, the spirit of God, the spirit of divine, by accompanying each other on a mutual journey, rather than leaving that responsibility to some outside entity while we cling tightly to what we know and instead project our anxieties onto each other. We ask that you help us to feel the deep gratitude that's meant to come with the gift of knowing each other and of being known. We ask for your divine curiosity to cure our tendency towards staunch criticality. God, guide us in this ongoing practice of being the bearer of peace and justice here with each other, to shift from what programs we might create for everyone else because it makes us feel good, to getting curious together about who we are and what we can become together. And finally, God, my deepest hope for our community today is that you help us to become people who are safe hosts for vulnerable spaces and sharing. Amen.
So we are entering into the season of Advent, and friends, we have a lot going on and will be going on in the days ahead. I want to let you know about some of those things, but before I do, I have two apologies to make. The first is to our online community. We are so sorry that the gremlins of technology were insurmountable last week, and we weren't able to do a live stream or a recording of the service. You were with us in spirit. We're so glad that you're back with us in sound and vision this week as well. But again, please accept our apologies for that. My other apology is that in the midst of the mayhem of trying to juggle a lot of plates that were wobbling, we had a time of ordination and installation and prayer for our new officers. And while they were physically present with us, I failed to mention two of those people by name. Lynn Murphy is our new elder for Mission and Peacemaking, and Kathy Reed is our new clerk of session. And so, on their behalf, I want to officially welcome them by name into those new roles in our life together in community. And thankfully, they were a part of that circle of prayer and of affirmation of their calling in their new roles. So to Kathy and Lynn, I'm sorry, and we're so thankful that you are part of our leadership now in Moreland. Things that are coming up. Let's start with tomorrow. Tomorrow is the annual neighborhood Selwood holiday tree lighting celebration. And our neighborhood organization reached out to our church asking if we had any carolers and people who would like to help lead caroling. And I sent that out to the choir, and we have a couple of folks from the choir who are joining me, I think joining Evan. Yeah, Evan's going to be there too. And so we're going to actually get a chance to lead our neighbors in caroling, which I think is really cool. So the event is tomorrow, the 29th. We're meeting at 5:30 at the Selwood Community House over close to 13th Avenue. And there will be some hot cocoa and a time of warmth and welcoming. And then around 6 o'clock, we will start making our way, a caroling we will go up 13th to the Holiday Tree, which is right at the point where 13th starts to turn into Bybee, up on the bluff there. The tree lighting will be at 6:30. And we invite you to come for all of that, to come for part of that, and represent as Moreland Press. And I know that we all love to carol. Well, this is a chance to do that with our neighbors. So that's tomorrow, starting at 5:30. We have started a warm clothing drive for transition projects, and specifically for Willamette Center. If you came in through the narthex this morning, you saw we have containers and already some donations. We will be receiving those donations throughout the Advent season and even through New Year's Day. So if you have new or gently used warm clothing items, we would love to receive those and be able to pass them along to those who need them in our community. We are having a Christmas pageant this year on the third Sunday of Advent, December 12th, and that is entitled Lessons and Carols in the Groove. I really like this. You're going to love it. Because in the wake of pandemic, we have not been able to have and host a children's choir. So Sarah Gibson, in her wonderful creativity, found a Christmas pageant based on rhythm and chant and telling and enacting the story without singing. So you're going to get a groove on while you're experiencing the Christmas story on December 12th. If you would like to be part of the group leading that story, it's for all generations this year. And our first rehearsal is this Tuesday night, 6:30, right? Isn't it? Or is it 6 o'clock? 6 o'clock, right here at the church. Evan and Sarah and myself and others will be there to help lead us in preparing for that Sunday. We'd love any and all of you to join us. There is an online form that you can fill out if you'd like to take a specific role. That's available, the link through the e-notes. But come and join us. It's going to be a great celebration. Charmaine, you have a question.
Yep. You said, Caroline, on Monday, 5:30 to 6:30, meet at the Selwood
Community House.
So there's the Selwood Community Center, which might have changed Community House, and then there's the place south of Tacoma on 13. Which one are we talking about?
The one that's north of Tacoma.
So the
by St. Agatha's.
Got it.
Yes. Yes, thanks for that delineation there, Charmaine. Yep. The Selwood Community House is right by St. Agatha's Catholic Church over in Selwood. Then we have three events coming, starting this Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, that we want you to know about. On Saturday, December 4th from 3 to 4:30, there is a wreath-making opportunity hosted by Susan Hoover and Holly Schoenbeck. And we would love to see you here for that. On Sunday following worship, next Sunday, December 5th, starting at 11 a.m., we will have Christmas photos available with a beautiful manger-esque setting here in the narthex. Jeannie will be taking the pictures, and those are available for individuals, couples, families, any amalgamation of people you'd like to get together to have a Christmas photo taken. That'll be happening after worship. And then on Monday the 6th, from 5:45 to 7 p.m., there will be a felted dove craft time in our fellowship hall. That will be hosted by Noelle Harding and Sarah Gibson. Lots of opportunities, folks, to engage, to reconnect, and connect more deeply with each other in this season. We invite you to pick one, to pick all of them, to come and join us. The other thing I want to highlight before we enter into our time of offering is that we have been given another incredible gift of offering from Kathy Williamson, one of our artisans, who has created barn doors, indoors, that have been put up this morning on the glass doors on Bybee. Once we have the ribbons available, we will also have note cards available for people who want to write out longer hopes and wishes and prayers to be able to attach to the indoors throughout the indoors, the indoors, throughout the Advent season. So be looking for that starting next Sunday, an opportunity. But Kathy, thank you so much. Make sure and check them out if you haven't following worship. They are astonishing, and you won't believe what they're made of. They're not made of wood. Thank you. Thank you for all of the gifts that you offer to our life together. Gifts of artistry and creativity, gifts of time and energy and talent, gifts of provision and resource. As we give thanks for the gifts we've been given, let's give back our gifts, our tithes, and offerings. Thank you. As Ian comes up, I just need to tell you something else. You know, Stephen Sondheim died on Friday. Tracy Ross did not know that I was going to be referencing him in my sermon, or that I was going to be referencing No One Is Alone. And yet somehow Tracy just happened to know to change his offertory to an arrangement of that very song. Talk about the magic of Christmas. The magic of the Advent season. Give thanks, friends. I give thanks for you, Tracy. And now, as we give thanks for all of God's amazing gifts in our lives, let's do that through praying together the prayer that Jesus taught his first followers to pray, the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, holy is your name, may your kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. But thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thanks, Ian. Our hymn of sending is a familiar carol with a less familiar verse from ancient times woven into it, O little town of Bethlehem. Let's lift our voices together. I invite you now to open your hands And if you want to join them with someone with whom you are sheltering, feel free, or extend them to someone else. Friends, though we may be living in times where it's hard to see the light now, just don't let it go. Things will come out right now. We can make it so. Friends, someone is on all sides. You are not alone. No one is alone. So may God bless us and keep us. May God's face shine upon us. May God's grace shine within us. And may God's loving presence be with us, within us, among us, around us, and beyond us, this day and every day. And now, receive our musical benediction. Please be seated. Jill and Julie, Evan and Brian, Tracy, thank you for sharing your artistry with us today. Jeannie and Sarah and Melissa, thank you for your artistry and presence today. And to each of you, go into this week and into this season with open eyes and ears, open minds and open hearts, open spirits and open lives. And know not only that there are gifts yet to emerge, but that you have gifts within yourselves to share. So friends, go in peace. And all God's children say, amen. Amen.